Well, 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 welcome everybody. If you've been wondering why people were so smitten with the head of the snake, it's, well, because of this. Today we're doing another video recapping the story. This is like the fifth or sixth I've done just on this one patch where Living World Season 3 started and I got to get pretty much everything in one video, maybe one and a half. Well, here we are again because we are dealing with Caudecus's correspondence. This item here you can see in my inventory. Now, you'll recall a while ago after I showed you what happened in Lake Doric, the new map that was released, which we can see on Tyria's surface just up here, you'll recall that on this map we found lots of little messages. There were missives from this mysterious character E and his attempts to defend Kryta from the incoming White Mantle attack and his preparations for it over the past few months. We hadn't heard anything of E for ages, and well, we went through that very similar to the E's correspondence little achievement chain you could do. Well, here in the final instance of the story for Caudecus's manor, I'm not actually technically in the final instance right now, this is the dungeon equivalent, but in this instance you could wander around and in all the different nooks and crannies of the place find Caudecus's messages, and they would slowly fill in this book here, Caudecus's correspondence. Now, this says incomplete for me, but it actually technically is complete. I've just lost and misplaced the actual complete book. Wow, and I can't even open it in the dungeon. Brilliant. All right, I guess we'll go out and read it. Well, today, on today's video, we're going to be going through this and seeing all of the incredible information that came from this that really does a lot to fill in the gaps behind the White Mantle story, the Civil War, Caudecus's involvement with it, and best of all, the ties between what we're currently experiencing and new player character creation if you're a human. So let's just go have a quick look at this. You guys will recall in 2012, if you made a new character, and even to today, but it first came out in 2012, you could select your gender, select your class, select what you want to look like. But then you could actually make a couple of decisions that would influence the personal story. First, we had this one here, where we were raised. We could be raised in the streets as a street rat. We could be raised as a commoner by common folk, or among the nobility as a noble. Then also you could choose between whether you'd never seen your true parents, whether you'd never recovered your sister's body, or if you'd passed up an opportunity to perform in the circus. These first three stories all were tied together by increased bandit activity around Divinity's Reach and potential associations those bandits might have had with the White Mantle. And these stories here dived even further into that. This story in particular, where you'd never seen your true parents, actually saw you as a player killing a White Mantle confessor. Yeah, like Confessor Caudecus that's had all this hype around him and the various confessors from GW1. You actually just kill a confessor in a random crappy little personal story instance way back in 2012. And it was never really referred to. It was one of the things I really didn't like about the personal story. Well, guess what happened with the head of the snake? They didn't just explain more behind this story or this story or this story, but every single one. They paint it all together into one cohesive narrative. And that is what you get from Caudecus's correspondence. Let's have a read then, shall we? All right, so Caudecus's correspondence. I wonder why they do have that disabled in the dungeon. Perhaps it's something to do with sequence breaking. These are messages from Caudecus that have been littered all throughout the manor. We're gonna go in order, but I'm not sure whether this is necessarily chronological order. I guess we'll see as we go through. My experience of having read these was as I was actually playing the instance and exploring all the little rooms off to the side. You'd be surprised how large Caudecus Manor is. And I love stuff like this that actually encourages you to go and look at the little nooks and crannies of various environments. Kind of like the Mistlock singularities and fractals that take you to weird places off the beaten track. Anyway, so letters 1 to 4. We've got concerning converts. And we're going to jump straight on in. So this is somebody writing to Caudecus, okay? And he's called at the moment Justicar Caudecus. So for those who aren't familiar, I mean, this stuff is really fantastic, guys. So I want to get you all, I want to paint the full picture here. If you're not familiar with the White Mantle ranking, currently, as we meet him in this patch and as we kill him in this patch, it's Confessor Caudecus. He's at the top. He's the top dog. This is a letter to Caudecus before he was Confessor, when he was only a Justicar. And you'll recall what I just mentioned, in the personal story there was a different confessor, remember? So this is Justicar Caudecus. And somebody's writing to him, they say this, they say, "I share your concerns with Confessor Ethel's newfound piousness. The white mantle are meant for greater things than playing servant to some has-been god. I've heard that you would like to offer an alternative direction for our order. Know that when the moment comes, you will have the support of my forces in Maguma. Written by Justicar Bauer. So Bauer, if you guys have been following my video since Living World Season 3 came up, you'll actually recognize this name. This is a character whose journals we got to find, not here in Kryta, but actually at Bloodstone Fen, when that first release came about. And we saw from those journals that this was a man who was working on the White Mantle project Operation Rebirth, whose purpose was to bring Lazarus the Dire back, but that he wasn't particularly interested in that. Here we can see that he's writing a message to Caudecus saying much the same, that he doesn't care so much about Operation Rebirth, but instead he'd rather focus on the practical applications of weaponizing Bloodstone magic and so forth, which we know that Caudecus cared about. So this is a very early message between these two characters. It's fantastic to see them tying Bauer from that first release into this one. And so he even says here, you'll have the full support of my forces in Maguma. So what this tells us here, guys, is that the White Mantle were looking at Bloodstone Fen and this idea of bringing Lazarus back since long before Caudecus was even the confessor. Because don't forget, here he's just called Justicar Caudecus. And what's really cool about this is we hear about the confessor before Caudecus, and it is Confessor Ethel. I think I'm saying her name right anyway. This is the woman we killed in the personal story! So how cool is that? This basically explains here that Ethel originally was the one who found this newfound piousness, right? Piousness, she cared more about her gods and Lazarus. She enacted all this stuff to start bringing back the god. And some of the members of the Order were sort of uneasy about that idea. Then during the personal story, wham, we came in as the player characters and killed the Confessor at like level 10. And that kind of threw them all through a loop. We'll get more information on Ethel very, very soon. So yeah, that's where it starts. Very cool. So moving on, we'll get more details on that in a second. Next one here is called Purge by Fire. Another letter to Caudecus before he's a Confessor. Okay, so around the same time, and again, we don't know who's writing this. Is it Bauer? Who is it? Well, let's read. So, my inquisitors have found yet another non-believer among your forces. We've purged her by fire as an example to the others, but I'm doubtful she'll be the last. All right, so it's obviously not Bauer, because this is a believer who doesn't like the non-believers, and Bauer would be a non-believer, right? Keep reading. It concerns me deeply that so many among our order, and specifically those under your command, Caudecus, seem to have forgotten our true purpose. To serve the unseen ones. If I didn't know better, I'd be questioning just how dedicated you are to that cause for the glory of the unseen High Inquisitor Zira. So I'm not, the High Inquisitor rank, I'm guessing, does outrank Justicar. So at this point, we have Ethel at the top. We have Zira sort of backing her up. We have Caudecus a little bit lower. And Zira and Ethel at least really care about Lazarus. And Zira is a character we actually met if you guys played the Raid Wing 3, Stronghold of the Faithful. We actually fight Zira in the sky up here. Can we see her arena by doing this? No, we can't. You actually fight Zira, a ridiculously powerful mesmer, who in the last throes of her life does actually manage to get the ritual complete, thus triggering the massive Bloodstone explosion, or saving us from the Bloodstone explosion. I really love seeing them fighting among one another here, because there's a fundamental question the White Mantle are asking themselves. All the way now, in this year, in Guild Wars 2's year, they're asking, what are we meant to be? Are we meant to be worshipping gods? Are we meant to be, you know, fulfilling the practical purposes of leading Kryta? And that question, fundamentally, has always been at the core of this organization. Look at Saul D'Alessio, and look at his original embracing of the Mersart, and look at, yes, their piousness in those early days, but what was it there for? It was to save Kryta from the Char. Really, it wasn't always about the gods as much as it was also about saving the peoples of Kryta and leaving them to prosperity when Orr and when Ascalon got absolutely annihilated. So I love how that kernel of discussion still reigns true even now. Let's move on. Falcon Company. All right, so players who played the personal story relating to their sister will recognize Falcon Company. I believe, I'm a bit rusty on this stuff, but I believe that our sister, our long-lost sister, was actually a member of Falcon Company. Either that or Falcon Company. Yeah, I think that was what it was. Anyway, so Minister. the deed is done. So this is a message between the White Mantle talking about Falcon Company, tying the White Mantle very explicitly to those aspects of the personal story. The deed is done. I accompanied your associates and we burned the Centaur camp. I personally ensured the War King's family did not escape with their lives. As we expected, the attack sent the beasts into a rage and they've begun more aggressive campaigns within Kryta. The evidence we've planted should be sufficient to point the blame at Falcon Company. I've enclosed the next patrol route per your request, and I expect my payment now. Captain Tavalen. Honestly, go back and play the personal story. It deals with the fallout of this, and it deals with Logan investigating this. I can still so clearly hear Troy Baker saying Captain Tavalen. Fantastic stuff. And so what we're seeing here is something that the developers actually described on their live stream. Caudecus was essentially making problems for Kryta so that he could swoop in and try to solve, to lead Kryta. It's like 250 years ago, Kryta had an obvious and real problem, the Char. What are Kryta's problems now? Well, Caudecus needed to ensure that they kept having problems so that he could undermine the throne and the White Mantle in general. All right. And then lastly, of these old ones, old ones, a timely promotion written to Justicar Caudecus. Still, he has no power. The Unseen Ones smile upon us. After years of searching, High Inquisitor Zira has found a lead on the refuge of our injured god, Lazarus. It would appear that, after he was betrayed by Navid over two centuries ago, Lazarus was forced to resplit himself into aspects to contain the corruption. Once imbued into artifacts, these aspects were scattered across the Magumba jungle and sites sacred to our order, and it is now our charge to gather these aspects. In our absence, and in light of your success discrediting the imposter on the Crichton throne, I am naming you second in command of the White Mantle. Do not disappoint me. So this explains a lot of stuff. Now, all this stuff about the queen being an imposter on the throne, I don't think any of these messages really go into whether there's some validity there or they just feel she doesn't deserve it. But what's very cool about this is we can see here why Caudecus became the second in command when instead Zira was the one who was already in that position is because Zira left. Once they realized everything about the ritual, once they realized all that Guild Wars 1 story, if you've missed that discussion, you can click the link on screen right now, guys, to my other video on this patch's lore. And at the very end, I discuss this stuff. But so... Zira's leaving, looking for all of these fragments all over the place, and that actually creates a power vacuum that Caudecus steps into. And this was probably a terrible mistake for Ethel, because she says, "Do not disappoint me," but Caudecus didn't care about this Lazarus stuff. This is a big problem that the old confessor created for herself. She just may not have realized it. And Caudecus manages to get that little bit deeper into the White Mantle to shift what it's fundamentally aiming for. So yeah, those are the very old ones. Let's move on to letters 5 through to 8. Here we have Flea-Bitten Bedfellows. And it's just written, Justicar. So this could be to Caudecus or maybe someone else. Don't forget, Caudecus had actually been promoted here. But yeah, another mystery character here. I'm going to do an accent and maybe you guys will guess who it is. The offering you have made of those responsible for the cowardly attack on our settlement has prompted me to reconsider your proposal. While I remain skeptical of your White Mantle and some of your promised intentions should Kryta return to your rule, I agree that the time to act has come upon us. You say you can clear the path to Divinity's Reach for my troops, and so I will send one of my High Sages with a warband at twilight tonight. If your claim is true, you will have earned my trust. Ogoth the Mighty, War King of the Modernists. Sorry about the crappy center accent there. This is from Ogoth! So, what happens at the very start of the game, guys? What have we learned here? When you make a new character, you spawn into an attack on Shaymor by the Centaurs. And this is a collaboration between the White Mantle forces that essentially was paving the way for that. And Ogoth, of course, appears again in the Harathi Hinterlands meta event chain. Moving on, we've got He Lives. Minister Caudecus, as I'm sure you're aware, a large warband of Centaurs attacked the village of Shaymor and laid siege to Shaymor garrison, nearly threatening the capital itself. Scouts following their tracks after the battle suggest that they marched directly through lands under your jurisdiction, along a patrol route assigned to the Ministry Guard, according to Captain Lange. I think even Lange appears in the personal story. Lives were lost in the attack, Minister. I must respectfully ask that you either whip your Ministry Guard into shape or get them out of my way. Captain Logan Thackeray, Commander of the Sheriff. I mean, this is so cool, right? And think about this geographically as well. Like, I've got to do this, right? This is where the game starts, guys. You spawn here, all right? The centaurs killing everyone in Shamor right on the doors of Divinity's Reach. Pretty bad stuff when you look at it in retrospect. We go here, and then we fight through the garrison, and we see that there was a staging ground of centaurs here, even to this day in the open world. But I guess we consider Queensdale to be frozen in time now, right? But so there's loads of centaurs here. That's really odd if you think about it, because there aren't too many centaurs. I mean, there's this location sort of nearby. But if you'll notice, if we consider Harathi and we consider getting centaurs from Harathi to here in Queensdale, where do we go through? We go through Beetleton. We go through Caudecus' land. I mean, it's so brilliant. I wonder if, and that's a speculation we could have made for years. I never made or thought of, and I don't know whether any of the community ever really, you know, was like, oh, Caudecus behind the centaur attacks. I mean, it was an easy speculation, but the specific geographical component to it. I wonder if the devs had thought about that. You know, if you draw a line between Olgoth, right, and that it's amazing. It's really, really, really cool. Anyway, so there we go. Moving on. And we get to see a bit from Logan. Very nice. Unrefined yet effective. My lord, Big Nose Ted got himself jailed again, along with more of your mutual acquaintances. If I hadn't gotten to them before Thackeray did, he'd be interrogating them right now. Now, if you guys know some of the human story, you might already know who this character is. They're becoming a liability. Are you quite sure I should release them again? Or should I make appropriate arrangements to prevent this from happening again? Commander Serentine, I think this might be the key farming character storyline. But yes, this is all personal story stuff, and it's tying it together. Here we've got a new protege. Jessicar, I just wanted to tell you again what a profound honor it's been to be involved into the fold. To tell you the truth, I thought the White Mantle were only a story told to scare children. I love this line. What you guys should understand is pre-Guild Wars 2, all right, the White Mantle, when they were discussing the lore of Guild Wars 2, of Tyria, 250 years after the first game, there was not much emphasis on White Mantle or Mersart stuff. There was a lot more emphasis on the conflict between the Shining Blade, the Ministry Guard, and the Seraph, and other things, because it was about more than just humanity, right? And so, really, if you read something like The Movement of the World, the only mentions you get of the White Mantle are that they, most citizens, if you look at a random person like Valera Jenkins here, or any random person, usually, they would have thought that the White Mantle were only a story told to scare children. That exact line is consistent with what they told us pre-release. And so to see it all the way out here, you see these callbacks that they're making. This is what makes the game feel like the story is consistent within itself and moving in a specific direction. This is exactly what I've wanted to see for years. This is the complete opposite of inventing new areas like South Sun Cove that plop into the lore out of nowhere and you know, going into all new directions, such as with the Aether Blades and a Molten Alliance and all this other stuff. Anyway, so keep reading. Not to say I don't think the game doesn't need a balance of both, but yeah. To discover that they not only existed, but that they possessed such an inspired vision for the future of Kryta, well, it's been a lot to absorb in a short amount of time. Remember in the Silver Wastes, everyone? Remember when we saw the message in the Silver Wastes on one of these old White Mantle outposts that describes the existence of a new Kryta, a vision of a new Kryta? I have this feeling that this is the beginning of a long and fruitful friendship. White Minister, or should I say initiative, Zamon, and Minister Zamon is one of the bad guys, again, in the personal story. So, there we go. And you have the really court thing, that's the nobility storyline. So, what I think they did there was they went street rat, commoner, nobility. Let's move on to letters 9 through 12. Sacrifices must be made. Caudecus, I'm told that I'm to stand trial for treason in the coming days. You need to act quickly, work your connections, make this go away. Let me make this perfectly clear to you. If I go down, I'm taking you with me. Do you understand, Minister Zamon? And if you guys remember that, I mean, I wish I could just play through all of the personal story stuff again with you guys. I think I did an old Alpha series where I played this exact storyline and I freaking loved it. I believe that Caudecus does get directly pointed out during this storyline where you do this thing with Zamon. Moving on, we've got the curtain falls. Minister, it would seem the Ringmaster was foiled, and he managed to lose the floating Griswell in the process. I suppose you were correct, and that a more direct approach is necessary. So what this is dealing with is those humans who did the circus storyline, which actually relates to the floating Griswell, which is related to an Asuran storyline. Kind of cool. Keep reading. I'll make preparations for our guest, but by Abaddon's beard, the char will be purged from our lands, Uzalan. So that's Uzalan, the inventor of the great mechanical orchestra, which we as scribes can now make. And of course, his connections were laid bare in the personal story. So we're seeing the other side, right? We're seeing their communiques during the personal story stuff. And it's now painted a full picture of what happened for the human storylines. I wonder whether this is possible for other races. Moving on, we got a minor setback. Ministers, let it be known that all charges against Minister Arton in regards to the tragic loss of Falcon Company have been cleared in light of new evidence verified by Captain Thackeray of the Seraph. This evidence suggests that Arton was deliberately framed by enemies of the Crown. While a thorough investigation is still underway, we intend to pursue these agents and bring justice upon them. We remind you that anyone found to be conspiring with enemies of Kryta will be punished swiftly and severely. And this is a message from the Queen that she sent out all over the place. No mention of the sister that was recovered, but hey, I suppose that makes us feel like a more realistic element of the world, in that that's not the notable part of the story. So this one here, I believe, is the last personal story one, and it's the most mind-blowing of them all. All right, guys? So that we can understand as we read it the first time, and we don't have to read it twice, what you guys should understand is this is in reference to the death of Confessor Essel. So painting the picture here, personal story, we, along with a couple of Shining Blade agents, locate them, the White Mantle, locate Ethel in the basement of a pub, and we sneak in there to assassinate her. We kill Ethel, all right? That's what happens in the personal story. Now, this is a letter about those events, and this letter, which we find in Caudecus' manor, is from E. So this is the other thing from E in the patch, and it's pretty crazy. All right, so E is writing this just before Confessor Essel is assassinated, right? E says, and we don't know to who, but E says, as a rule, I tend not to trust anonymous letters, but I'm sending this note back with your bird because of the gravity of what you wrote. If what you say about a planned assassination and about the identity of the White Mantle Confessor is true, I can't afford not to act. That being said, I give you the same warning I give all new informants. I don't like being toyed with. We will be watching the target to see if this assassination attempt actually comes to pass. If it does, I'll consider the validity of the rest of your claim. And if it doesn't, I'll be forced to demonstrate just how seriously I take these matters. E. Okay, oh good. All right, so wrapping our head around this is quite hard, all right? Because you're probably wondering, is Caudecus actually involved in this conversation? So if we go from the perspective that Caudecus was the one who tipped E off about the fact that the Confessor was going to be assassinated, we have to wonder why. Now, I think there actually is a chance Caudecus could have tipped E off as to that, because maybe he wants E on side once Caudecus seeks to rise in Ethel's place. And we know that Caudecus didn't really care about Ethel's piousness. So it's kind of like Caudecus moves into the organization, becomes second in command, and then helps to orchestrate the death of Ethel somehow and tips E off to it. But what does he gain from tipping E off? It's curious. Or was this not about Caudecus at all? Was this another member of the White Mantle? But then why would any member of the White Mantle be telling E if E, as he's demonstrated through his notes in Lake Doric, is not in favor of the White Mantle? So there is another option here. The last option is that this is a message between, you know, like a member of the Order of Whispers or a member of the Seraph or someone who's newly joined E's order, because what you see E says here, he says, I'll give you the same warning I give all new informants. So, and this is the one I think is most likely. This could be someone has joined E's group of information gatherers, right? Who aren't the Shining Blade, who aren't the White Mantle, who aren't the Order of Whispers. They're on their own, right? Someone's joined and become a new informant E, and they found out about this assassination attempt, and now they've told E, because it's obviously going to be very important that people understand what the White Mantle do in wake of this, right? And so E thinks, oh my god, this is huge news, writes back to that informant, but the informant is killed or intercepted. The White Mantle grab the message. So now the White Mantle know that E knows that there's an assassination that's about to happen, and that's why it's now in Caudecus' manor, because the White Mantle intercepted this communique, and then that's how perhaps they then tried to prepare for the death of Confessor Ethel. And maybe, you know, Caudecus, knowing this information, then sort of worked it to his advantage later. I don't know. I don't really think that this is a direct communication between E and the White Mantle. I think the White Mantle got their hands on this message, because, again, remember, if you guys saw the other video where I talked about all of E's messages, what you were actually finding here was a lot of the people who had messages from E were dead. They'd been killed. And here's the other thing. In the personal story where you'll hunt down Confessor Ethel, you're with Shining Blade. And I believe a couple of the informants of E on this map are Shining Blade. So there could be some members of the Shining Blade who have been informing E about stuff as new initiates. And this happened way back then, behind the scenes in the personal story. It's fantastic. I love to hear what you guys think about this one. This is one of the most interesting ones. That's what I interpret from it, though. And maybe I'm missing something really major. I'd love to see in the comments. All right, moving on. We got letters. Did we just do... Yeah, we did 9 to 12, correct? Yeah, the enemies of my enemy. All right, moving on. So we got 13 to 16 under new management. Confessor Caudecus. Here we go. So Ethel is finally dead. Caudecus has risen up. Just the bulk of stuff they've got here about Ethel makes her feel like much bigger part of the story. I hated the Ethel thing from personal story. It was so short. It was so hand-waved. Oh, it was ridiculous. You can tell that in 2012, they just slapped the word confessor on there, even though they gave it no due diligence. This is the due diligence that we wanted in 2012, and I'm not a big believer in too little too late. It's here in game now, and it's fantastic, and I'm very happy for it. All right, so anyway... Under new management, Confessor Caudecus, allow me to congratulate you on your promotion. Confessor Ethel lacked the foresight needed to lead us. The ease with which she was killed and exposed clearly showed her faults. Yes! Oh, look at this. See, there. That's exactly what I was always thinking, right? Like, it's annoying how easily we killed her. And, you know, they've allowed us to have that belief and expressed it in game. It's brilliant. The White Mantle will finally have the guidance it needs to carry it into a great and glorious future. Per your orders, we're shifting our focus to researching a means of weaponizing the Bloodstone. So Caudecus is in control. He reshifts their focus. You should know, however, that Zira, who has been off in the jungle, remember, and has always cared about Lazarus, Zira is less than enthusiastic about the change in leadership. She and her lapdog Matthias have been throwing around some fairly treasonous accusations against you. And remember, what do we fight in the raid? We fight the White Mantle that cared about Lazarus, and we kill Matthias here, and we kill Zira here. Brilliant stuff. So she's levying some fairly treasonous accusations against you. You would be wise to keep her on a tight leash, lest she spread further dissent among the ranks of the Mantle. Of course, you can trust me to keep you informed. And that's Bauer. Bauer, who was in on the Bloodstone Fen stuff, but never really cared about it, as we learned in the previous release. Brilliant stuff. Old friends, older enemies. General Beetle. So somebody writes to Caudecus, but he calls him General Beetlestone. So, not necessarily among the White Mantle here. And says, when I heard your queen was selling out Ascalon to the Char, I was afraid you were on board with that madness, that you'd forgotten about your soldiers out here in the trenches. I appreciate your note, and I'm glad you're as disgusted with this treaty as I am. If your White Mantle pledge to free Ascalon from the Char, then you have the Separatist support, and mine. It will be an honor to fight alongside you once again, General. Together, we will cleanse these lands. Now, that's Captain Delana. Captain Delana, I don't really remember. I think could be a Vigil storyline thing where you're dealing with the Separatists and the Renegades from the Char War. But again, like, that has always been a component. Caudecus hates the Char, and so I like seeing that one too. The next one's called Trouble at Home. It's a bit more personal. Father. Ah, so we know from the main story, this is Demi. She says, you promised there would be no more secrets between us. How then do you explain what I found in the basement? The weapons? The unsavory looking brutes? I wonder who the unsavory looking brutes are, just White Mantle thugs? And these letters from, or bandits maybe? And these letters from Mother? What did she learn that made her say these things? Is that why she left? If you hadn't driven her away, those bandits would never have found her and she'd still be alive. So we speculate about the Mother, and we do get a bit more on the Mother in this patch, but not too much. But the mum obviously found out what Caudecus was doing, ended up hating for it, and as we found out in the main story, Caudecus killed her over it. By the Six, I'm not even sure it was the bandits that killed her. Was it you? Is that why Landon was the one to find her? Was it you all along, Father? Another reference to an older character. I'm leaving for good this time. I know people who can protect me from a monster like you, from everything you are, from everything you've done. You'll never hurt me again, Demi. And as soon as she writes this message, the Order of Whispers personal storyline begins, where we go out to, with Tybalt, Demi basically writes this, guys, and then she runs away to Gendarren Fields, and we from Lion's Arch with Tybalt and the Order of Whispers seek out to find her. And that's when those stories happen. And the White Mantle hunt her down into the town and we escort her out. Oh, it's brilliant. Until eventually she gets to the Order of Whispers and she's been there ever since. You'll never hurt me again, she says. And that's kind of sad, right? Because he will. He's gonna kill her. Pirates? Really? Minister Caudecus, there's been a development of sorts. Those filthy jackdaws claim to have the me, but when we went to liberate the girl, someone had already absconded with her. Here you go, and this is the story. This is the Order of Whispers story. We found one of the pirates, name of Drake, passed out and reeking of grog. If you guys remember, you have a competition against this guy in the personal story, a drinking competition. I don't know how reliable his intel is, but he mentioned a char and another pirate he didn't recognize, so I figure she has help. It appears that they're making their way to Lion's Arch. Provided this tracking enchantment doesn't wear out, I'll continue to provide updates on their whereabouts, Commander Landon. And I believe you kill Landon by blowing up some barrels of apples right outside the Order of Whispers headquarters. And so, finally, three more messages here. Or four more messages, sorry. We've got a Wii problem. So, how are the Wiis involved in all of this? You guys will recall, in current events at the moment, there was a suggestion that there's a leak, there's a snake, there's a spy in the Dermond Priory, and there have been some subtle suggestions of one in the Order of Whispers too. Well, check this out, a Wii problem. Confessor, you'll never guess who showed up at the Chantry of Secrets today. Or knowing you will, knowing you, maybe you will, it's Demi. So when we escorted Demi to the Chantry of Secrets, one of the people present there was a white mantled spy. I sort of hate this. The Chantry of Secrets and the Order of Whispers, these guys should be super well hidden. But maybe they can have flaw. Maybe they're more realistic if they can be infiltrated themselves. So some white mantle infiltrated the Order of Whispers. Keep reading. Apparently, your dearly departed wife's cousin, Lady Wii, coaxed her from her comfortable lifestyle and spent the last 2 days interrogating her. Don't worry, she didn't have much actionable intel. It appears she bolted from the manor before she could gather enough evidence to pin anything overly treasonous on you. Still, you should expect the Order to watch you more closely from now on. So I kind of like these messages and I kind of don't. One of the criticisms I had of the story for a while was, like, Demi defected and had all this information. Why didn't the Order of Whispers do anything for years? And I like this message because it explains that, well, she didn't actually have anything that great. So it's been explained, but I don't really like the explanation because it's just a bit lame, really. Oh, Demi didn't even have anything, but fine. Moving on, she says, as for the leads they've got, because in the personal story, guys, Demi acts like she knows tons of stuff. Anyway, as for the leads they've got, I'll do whatever I can to make sure they result in dead ends. Emphasis on the dead part. So maybe lots of people were killed to get around this. I await your instructions on what should be done about Lady Wii. And it's signed by no names. Even in plural, no names. I mean, this is really interesting. So who is it? There could be a very cool Order of Whispers story coming up. A very cool one where we find out it's some ridiculously high-ranking person who's in cahoots with them. I mean, I doubt real Darkwater or the Master of Whispers would be it, but this could be quite interesting. Moving on, we got an eye for an eye, a child for a child. Now, I believe, I can't quite remember, but I think this is actually now dealing with where we started this video, and that's the dungeon storyline. Minister Beetlestone, it would be my pleasure to perform for you. How can I refuse when you offer such magnificent instrument as a gift? You truly are too kind. I'm sorry to hear that Demi won't be in attendance. It's been far too long since I last saw her, and I'd love the opportunity to catch up. Perhaps another time. Thank you again, Lady Valette Wii. This next one, yet another protege. So what is the title? What is the title in reference to? Another protege? Well, actually, what we're dealing with here is the Lady Wii from the story, the daughter of the woman in the Order of Whispers. And so she says, Minister Beetlestone, I know you said I could call you Caudecus, but old habits die hard. Thank you for attending my performance. I've had a chance to think about the discussion we had afterwards. With so much threatening Kryta, the centaurs, the bandits, and the char plots you've uncovered, I'd be lying if the promise of a safer and stronger Kryta didn't sound promising. What char plot are they talking about there? Maybe I'm missing something on that. It feels wrong going behind my parents' backs like this, but they wouldn't listen. Between father's loyalty to the queen and mother's insistence that she knows everything without explaining how, and of course she would, because she's a member of the Order of Whispers, well, I'll just have to show them myself. Once they see things improving, they'll have to admit that I was right. I'll come to that meeting you invited me to, just to see what it's all about. And thank you for listening. It's nice to be treated like an adult by someone, for a change, Valette. And so that's how he kind of gets Valette in after he loses his daughter, like manipulates her, treats her like an adult. I can totally see this. This is very, very cool. And finally, we have And Stay Dead. And so this is very similar to the big message we get at the end of the story, but it's slightly different. It says, Confessor, it wasn't easy, but I managed to swap the artifacts you requested, just in time too. Zira took off north without so much as a word. I wish I could be there when the smug zealot's ritual fails, when her followers turn on her and come crawling back to us. Perhaps I'll allow some to return, but most will be fed to the Bloodstone. This is Bauer. And he says, I'm sure you've delayed your relocation to the Queen's Palace for as long as you can. So I'll find a way to get in touch with you there going forwards. Until then, Confessor. And so, like, one thing I love about how all of this is structured, right? All of these is it's like what happened to the White Mantle in Zira's absence. And a lot happened. A lot happened. And it could be what pulls them apart as we, the heroes, come in and storm through the place. The other thing I really like about this message is he says, I'm sure you've delayed your relocation to the Queen's Palace for as long as you can. As you guys will recall, another thing that I really didn't like about the personal story and the living world is that Caudecus, at the end of the story, was commanded to go to the palace, and yet he just stayed at the place forever. Like, and they just never explained it. It was like a plot hole. It was so annoying. It was like the devs didn't know what they'd written. And well, here, they've kind of explained it, that, oh, it's something that he was actually trying to do to stay in. You know, just having that there, justifying why he got to stay around for so long, means a lot. And, well, there you go, guys. I thought these were brilliant. It is kind of harder when you're getting stuff like that. There's two criticisms I have to this format of giving people lore. And I love that there's all this lore, and they're taking this opportunity to put in a lot of world building and explain things. This is cheap. This is easy for them to do. It's text. It's what they should have been doing from a long time ago. I love it. There's only two things I sort of don't like. One is, it kind of sucks picking these up and getting them all jumbled. Like, this perspective you get at the end, reading it all in chronological order, like, makes it much clearer. But when you actually experience it in-game, you might get letter 17 first, then letter 5, then letter 12, then letter 2, and it makes a lot less sense. But the truth is that where you pick these up in the area has nothing to do with their contents. So I'd rather the system got changed a little bit so that it didn't matter which one you picked up. It always gave you the information in order, if you get what I mean. Like, it shifts dynamically based on which ones you've collected. So the last letter, no matter which one it is you find in the place, will always have the contents of letter 20. Do you get what I mean? That'd be really nice. And the other thing is, all of these letters, they only reveal who's written them at the end. And sometimes that can be really cool, right? So, like, the enemies of my enemy. You're reading it, it doesn't make any sense, it doesn't make any sense, and then you see it's E, and you're like, whoa, I've got to reread it again. But that can be actually kind of frustrating to like, hold all in your head for every single one. I think it would be better if, for most of them, we just got to see who wrote the letter at the first, at the start, and then we can, you know, enjoy it instead. Because I basically read every single one of these twice. Just once with the context of who it was, and then second without, and I think maybe that's a bit unnecessary. Anyway, I think it's brilliant, and I'm really happy to share this with you guys. If you never went in, if you never found them, if you missed a lot of the connections, because by God, there are a lot of connections, and I'm sure if you scroll down into the comments, people will be very kindly sharing even more. Brilliant stuff, so much to talk about in this patch, and there you go, guys. That is basically now everything. That's the head of the snake. That's like six videos just summing up what we learned in the head of the snake. So much Crichton stuff, so much was touched on. I think the devs did an epic job. And next time we return for a story video, we'll be asking some pretty interesting questions, like, oh, I don't know, who's Lazarus? That should be pretty cool. I'll see you guys next time. Paid his debt to the Lucky Horseshoe, he was eventually fingered by one of his victims and tried as a thief. His punishment was exile from the kingdom of Kryta. The local authorities blindfolded him and rode him out 3 full weeks before leaving him to fend for himself. Alone, broken, lost, Saul wandered through a dense forest for several days, surviving on only roots and berries. On the fourth day,